The opinions expressed by individuals and guests do not necessarily reflect those of WRGN Rain Radio ATL or Sound Feast Media LLC. And I don't know if you'll ever hear me, but I got salt in my wounds from the tears that resulted. Every hurt shows we're mortal. And
hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up?
This is a deep recording, man.
Welcome to the Word on the Streets with JP. I'm your host, JP, and you're not going to want to miss today's Sound Feast in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Can't stop, won't stop. Where the brakes at? I give them that ditty bop. Like, take that, take that, take that.
Welcome to another episode of Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP. And again, I say thanks for checking me out today. Today is May the 24th, 2021. And it was a very interesting weekend. I never thought I'd say thank God it's Monday, but thank God it's Monday. And so I'm grateful for God's mercy. It was very interesting, but we survived. And so here we are. I wanted to come to you today to stress to you that I believe that the rapture is near and even at the door. In saying that, my concern is that a lot of us who claim to love the Lord will be left behind, and we need to get it together. So now I understand how this makes me look, because we've been told this our whole lives, that Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming any minute. Jesus is coming back, and it hasn't happened yet. The difference between then and now is that the Bible prophecies are being fulfilled right before our eyes. What really woke me up was the attack of Jerusalem by Hamas. That really woke me up. So before we get into everything, it's going to be a really, really good show, but a short show. But yeah, it's going to be chock full of information, so get your pencil and papers out. But before we do all that, I want to go to the Lord in prayer real quick. Lord God, we are so grateful that you chose us to live in this appointed time. We are honored to be a part of what you call in your word, the chosen generation. And we desperately look forward to that blessed hope of Jesus' return for his church. So please empower us to do what is your perfect will. Give us a heart for those in whom you love with the same intensity as you have loved us with. Please protect us as we carry your message to all we come in contact with, and give us the holy boldness that we need to carry out what we are called to accomplish in this earth. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. All right. Yeah, a lot of things are going down, and yeah, we just pray for the peace of Jerusalem, number one. I know that a ceasefire was called and everything seems to be toning down, but I believe this to be just the calm before the storm. And or maybe we're in the eye of the storm. The storm is actually already started, and so we got to be paying attention as believers in Jesus, that these things were mentioned and prophesied in his word. These are the things we should be looking for. So I was doing this study, and in the middle of the study, I had a memory of my dad. And so I want to share this story with you as it pertains to what I'm going to be talking about. So I remember when I was about 4 or 5 years old, and this had to be right around 1970. And we were a military family and lived on an Air Force base in Indiana. I remember it like it was yesterday. So back in those days, there was almost no crime on military bases, except for the smaller ones like, you know, vehicle accidents and shoplifting and stuff like that, but no violent crime on military bases as a whole. So my mom felt safe enough to let the neighbors know that we would be left alone or unattended for about 10 minutes as she went to pick up my dad from work. So she put me and my sister down for a nap. My sister's only 8 months older than me, so we were like really, really, you know, small children. But she put us down for a nap, and then she went to pick up my dad from his job. And she had just spent the first part of our day bonding with my sister making cupcakes. And so before she walked out the house, she gave a staunch warning to us not to eat the cupcakes while she was gone. They were still hot on the cookie sheet sitting on the kitchen counter, and she made sure that she emphasized, don't touch this, do not touch this. So in those days, you could actually do that, leave your kids for a short while, go tell the neighbors. Most of the neighbors already had a key to your house, and they were really watching out. We need to get back to that sort of behavior as the church. Anyway, so she warned us, she warned my sister, don't touch these cupcakes, girl. Well, I'm gonna be back in just a minute. I'm gonna know if you did, okay? So, but what my mother didn't know was that my sister was not focused on the cupcakes, but she had her eye on the little jars of candy sprinkles that mom used to sprinkle over the cupcakes as they cooled down. So as she watched mom put them in the cabinet above the refrigerator, she began to plan her diabolical scheme. As soon as she heard the garage door raise and the engine of the car fire up, here she comes to my room. I can still remember her words. She said, JJ, that's what they called me back then. JJ, are you sleeping? I said, oh, Lord. I looked at her and I knew that we was about to get into some trouble. So she grabbed me by my hand. And you know, she grabbed me by my hand that she was really sucking up to get me to do something. But she led me to the kitchen. And since I was the most accomplished climber of the two of us, she in no uncertain terms instructed me to the countertop and then up to the freezer door where I would obtain the prize, those candy sprinkles. We didn't have enough sense to just take a fistful of sprinkles and then dip. As she found her place on the countertop, I sat on the top of the refrigerator with my legs dangling down over the door of the freezer. It was easy enough getting up there, but I never considered the climb down. I sat there crying and eating sprinkles, scared to death that I was going to fall trying to get down. Then all of a sudden, we heard mom and dad's keys as they unlocked the door that led out to the garage, which just happened to be right next to the refrigerator. Lord have mercy. My sister said, okay, JJ, I gotta go now. I gotta go now. But if you be real still, they won't see you. Boy, I tell you, 4 and 5 year old folks, anyway. So my sister said, deuces, and she dipped on me. Yeah. So that's what I did as she ran around the corner and up the steps and jumped into her bed. I heard her. I was so scared. I was too scared to be mad. The first face I saw as they made their way into the house was my mom's. She walked right by me. And by golly, Drea was right. She couldn't see me. So that be real still part, that was me being invisible. Then came through the door my dad. I shuddered in fear as our eyes locked. I said, oh no, he saw me. I just knew I was dead meat. But lo and behold, he walked right by me and struck up a conversation with my mom in the kitchen. Then he yelled upstairs and said, kids, we're home. And as my sister came running down the stairs and down the hallway, he asked her, where's your brother? Andrea looked up at me, and then she looked at dad and she lied right to his face and said, I don't know. As she wiped the residue of candy sprinkles off her face, she gave one of those little pitiful puss in boots looks to my dad. So they pretended to look for me. They looked in the stove, they looked under the dining room table, they looked under the sink, even went back out into the garage. And as I began to cramp up from trying to be invisible, I just gave in and said, I'm sorry, Daddy. Drea made me do it. He looked up at me like, there you are, you know. He reached up and he grabbed me and said, nobody made you do it. You made a choice to be led to this whooping I'm about to give you. I was mortified. I was like, oh my gosh, my dad never gave me a whooping. He was about to whoop me today. But consequently, I never got that whooping because Dad said that that was about the funniest thing he had ever seen. And because I realized what the consequences could have been, I never did anything like that again. We laughed about that for years. So he later in life told me the reason he didn't spank me was because of how quickly I apologized. And after the day that he had just had, that little stunt really cheered him up. His mercy on me that day taught me a life lesson that I still remember. So, yeah, his mercy, that was really an amazingly powerful thing that he taught me that day about mercy. So, getting back into the teaching, I thought that that was something cute to talk about and that it'll directly pertain to the teaching that I'm going to teach today. So I hope we are all watching world events and recognize them as what they are, indicators of the sign of the coming of Jesus for his church and the end of the age. Even if Jesus tarries for the next few years, we are definitely witnessing the signs that mark the end of the age for sure. I believe we are entering into an era that will change our lives forever. So we'll be able to say very soon, welcome to the new normal. We're in the new normal now, you know. Freedom of speech isn't so free anymore. There's surveillance everywhere. We can't get the whole truth or sometimes none of the truth out of the media. It's just, this is the new normal. So we are witnessing this on the world stage. And what makes that so sad is it seems that the body of Christ is falling in line. We are witnessing the hearts of people turning away from God and the things of God. So let me stop right there. I know I teach some hard messages and most people, it's very uncomfortable for them, but I challenge you to hang in here with me today. So, like I said, we're witnessing a lot of people turning away from God and the things of God. We become a society of compromise, and we can attest that people who used to be active in Christ and the things of God are beginning to buckle under the cancel culture pressure and even endorse things that they know aren't pleasing to God. I believe many are giving in to great delusions and are being seduced with other things rather than the things of God. So even if we don't endorse these things, we stand idly by and let these things happen rather than standing up for the truth. Where's the truth nowadays? We are seeing this, and this is indicative of what the Word of God calls the great falling away. It's right in our faces, but most will be blinded to the truth. So I'll say it again. Christ is coming back soon. Because two things make this event possible. One is the travail of Israel. It's going down, y'all. It's happening, and we're watching it. And so we're not getting the whole truth here. So did you know that the state of Israel is the indicator to what era we're living in? Damascus is raging. Israel has suffered an attack of over 4,000 long and short-range missiles within the last couple of weeks, resulting in substantial loss of life on both sides. The Israelis have to live in fear and make sure that they are minutes away from neighborhood bomb shelters. Israel election process has been stalled for one reason or another as the government is divided, kind of like our government is divided. Democrats, Republicans, Lord have mercy. What in the world is going on? You know, a house divided can't stand. Anyway, the threat of the U.S. re-entering the Middle East nuclear arms deal. Why in the world would we want to do that when the last administration had that puppy under control? Israel has enemies encamped all around them. Everybody is not in attack mode, but you can see that tensions are rising. And these are the things we should be watching as the body of Christ. The second indicator is that there will be a great falling away from the faith. There are many in the church that really aren't Christians nowadays. Some just attend because that's what they've always done, or they attend because that's their social outlet. Some go because they just want to get out of the house, or, you know, or it's just something that their family's always done. The bad thing about it is that they are of the world and bring worldly behaviors into the church, and the Christians who are in the church that are earnestly trying to cultivate a real relationship with the Lord aren't being bold enough to call it out. This causes compromise, and even those who are trying begin to be influenced by those who are of the world. Thus the title of this message, Among Us But Not Of Us, Introduction to the Unbelieving Believers. So it's time for the body of Christ, those members who are straddling the fence of faith, to make up their minds one way or the other. God respects that you follow him, and he respects that you don't. But it's that one that's in the middle, that lukewarm Christian, that he said he's going to spit out of his mouth. It's time for those who are sincere about serving the Lord to actually do that. And we can start with standing up for the truth. Just saying, whether you walk it out or not, if you're considered a Christian by the world, you'll still be hated. So make up your mind. Either you're in the church, in the body of Christ, or you're not. Either be about it or go away. We will still be hated because of his namesake if we call ourselves Christians, whether we walk it out or not. And that being the case, we may as well be persecuted for our faith. You know, be all in or don't be at all. I believe that this is why there is such a great falling away. People are realizing that if they're called a Christian, they're being treated a certain way all of a sudden. Most want to avoid the ostracization and begin to compromise in order to avoid loss of worldly friends and the promise of loneliness. Because if you're really walking this thing out, your friend corral is almost empty. Because those people that you used to dig and hang out with that are in the world or compromising, you can't get with them anymore. And so you're down to one or two, if you're lucky. No, I don't use luck. You're down to one or two. So it's time for us to encourage one another in the Lord and begin to disciple those young believers and to start exercising holy boldness in order to reel back in those older lost believers. According to the word, many will still not humble themselves and turn away from their wicked ways and begin to walk with Christ. They want to stay in that same behavior that's going to lead them to something very tragic. I feel led to stress these issues because time is definitely winding up, man, if you're not watching. And even if you are watching, time is winding up regardless. But if you're watching, you know it for sure. Even in the church, we are seeing people who have absolutely no reverence for God, the things of God, the house of God, just have no reverence. So we are smack dab in the middle of what the word calls the great falling away, as spoken of in 2 Thessalonians, the 2nd chapter, the 1st through the 5th verse. And it reads, starting in verse 1, King James Version, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him," verse 2, "that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand." So he's saying, man, nothing should bother you. You should concentrate on the Lord at this point. Verse 3, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for the day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." So he's saying, don't be deceived. Him just stressing the fact that he doesn't want us to be deceived gives an indication that there's going to be widespread deception. So he's saying that's the first thing you need to watch out for, is deception. He says, "For the day shall not come except there come a falling away first." So we're going to start seeing people just leave the church. Not only leave the church or leave church attendance, but leave the body of Christ and start believing in all sorts of other crazy stuff, like the burning of sage and, you know, just stuff that isn't pleasing to God. He talks about the son of perdition. So there'll come a time where this person is probably already on the world stage, but we just don't know who he is yet. He hasn't announced himself yet. Verse 4, the man of perdition who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God. So we're already seeing that right now. So if the governments in which were founded upon the tenets of the word of God are starting to fall away from that, then that means that there's a protagonist out there or a group of people that are anti-Christian. And so we're seeing that right now. So that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So this guy is possessed by Satan and he really believes that he's God. And so we'll start seeing that soon. So it's time to pay attention so we can gauge where we are in God's timeline. So as we begin to see these things begin to unfold, we must encourage one another, because I believe that things are about to get hard for Christians and hard for those who claim to be Christians and are not. We are already seeing the things of God being balled up and thrown in the trash as our moral compass is almost non-existent. In 1 John, the second chapter, the first through the ninth verse, the message is clear, and we should be paying even more attention and remaining mindful of what we are called to do in these last days. As the church empties out, we should be filling it back up. This passage of scripture is designed to encourage those who are tired or having trouble forgiving themselves, as John reminds us of who Jesus is. And so those are some of the reasons why people fall out of the church. They have church hurt, or they think that they're not worthy to sit in the house of God, and all sorts of crazy, crazy reasons. But no reason is a good reason to fall away. Okay, so John reminds us of who Jesus is, what we need to do in order to get back in right standing with God, and what Jesus has done for us. In the following scripture, we are going to actually be able to gauge who is sincere in their Christian walk and who's not. If anybody in the body of Christ continually or consistently refuses to walk in the manners that are pleasing to God, they are among us, but not of us. And these are the ones in whom we need to be looking out for or watching out for. It's important that we pay close attention to what this is saying, because being able to spot these signs and these individuals could mean the difference in minimizing loss to the body of Christ and the deception that Jesus warns us about in Matthew 24, the 4th through the 5th verse, of which I'll read right now. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceives you. Verse 5, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, or I'm a Christian, and shall deceive many. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. So that's what's going to happen. It says, if it were possible, insomuch that if it were possible, and it is possible, because we're not in our word, and we're not hanging around our Christian accountability partners, and we have private secret sins that we still entertain and then ask for forgiveness and entertain and ask for forgiveness instead of just repenting and stepping away from that thing, walking in the total opposite direction. You know, the Bible says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. So there will be many of the elect that will be deceived also. These are most likely those who are the ones who are lukewarm, those who continue to entertain secret sin, like I said, and those who are offended at being corrected. Three indicators. If this weren't the case, there would be no need for this warning and reminder in 1 John, the second chapter, the 1st through 19th verse, and it reads as follows. Well, before I say that, God gives us all that we need for this life and godliness. In saying that, we who are serious are going to need to walk in the Spirit and employ what we know in addition to the spirit of discernment. And so now I'll go into 1 John, the second chapter, the 1st through the 9th verse. But I'm going to read it in the NIV this time. I believe that it's a little more understandable. The great falling away is occurring. The infiltration of the church is occurring. So starting out in verse 1, NIV, it says, "My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father on our defense. He's our propitiation, and that's Jesus Christ, the righteous one." Verse 2, "He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the entire world." Verse 3, "We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commandments. The man who says, 'I know him,' but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Verse 5, "But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him." Verse 6, "Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did." Verse 7, "Dear friends, I am not writing you a new commandment, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard." Verse 8, "Yet I am writing you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining." Verse 9, "Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother is still in the darkness." Verse 10, "Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him to make him stumble." Verse 11, "But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. He does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded him." Verse 12, "Write to you, dear children, because your sins have been forgiven on account of his name. Write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, dear children, because you have known the Father." Verse 14, "Write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God lives in you, and you have overcome the evil one." Verse 15, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loved the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Verse 16, "For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of the eyes, and the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world." Verse 17, "The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever." Verse 18, "Dear children, this is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour." Verse 19, "They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us." So let me go back to verse 18. He says, "Dear children, this is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have already come, and this is how we know it is the last hour." And the answer is in verse 19, "They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their going showed that none of them belonged to us." God is sovereign and full of mercy, just like my dad was on that hot summer day back in 1970. If any of these scriptures describes you and you really want to turn things around with the Lord, just know that in the same way my dad forgave me, God will forgive you if you just repent and turn away from these things that so grieve God, never revisiting that behavior again. If you don't know Jesus in the pardoning of your sins, and you want to, or you already know the Lord but have been missing the mark, please, I invite you to say this prayer with me. You need to get this thing back in the road so we can be found doing his will should he return. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I'm in need of your mercy and forgiveness. So please forgive me and thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. I acknowledge you as Lord. So please come into my heart that I might live for you. Please be my God, and I will be your child. It's in your name, Jesus, the Savior, that I pray. Amen. So I believe that if you said that simple prayer, that you are born again, or you have rededicated your life, your entire life, to the Lord. If you said that prayer, then I want to be the first to say welcome to the family of faith. And so my first recommendation for you would be to attach yourself with a group of believers. I mean, for real believers. You know, a ministry that teaches and rightly divides the word of God. Get involved with the church. Turn that heart of stone into a heart of flesh again and begin to love on one another like Jesus commanded us to. Okay, so if you like what you heard and you want to hear more, you can follow Word on the Street with JP on Facebook. You can also friend me personally. My name is Jay Parker, J-A-Y Parker. You can find me there on Facebook as well. Instagram, you can find me at j.parker.radio. Or you can find Word on the Street with JP at www.108praiseradio. Last but certainly not least, you can find Word on the Street with JP on Clark TV Network. That's C-L-A-R-K-E TV Network. Go ahead and download the app to be able to catch all the shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week on any smart device. So thank you so much for listening and watching Word on the Street with JP. I'm your host, JP. And my final message to you is be blessed to be a blessing. And until next time, that's right, we'll see you on the radio.